Bob Prash and Shiva Kalidasa with the Tibetan Kapalika Gore Path. We're going to talk about some of the perils on the spiritual path. There are many. One is the illusion of power. There are many people who believe that they are the source of power in their lives, and they're not. We are all a part of the goddess. We are one with her. She is the be-all and end-all of creation. And we are a part of her and a reflection of her. So, to say that we have the power is a bit of a misnomer. In the Cherokee heritage that I was raised in before I learned the Tibetan end of things, we were always told that we were the hollow bone. And the hollow bone is simply a channel for the power of the Creator to flow through. So, as people work in the process of their spiritual lives and their work, and they, especially if they get into healing work and things, and doing different types of things with energy, then sometimes they get to the point that a massive amount of energy can flow through them, and it's really good, and it can be a little bit deceiving. There was a lady years ago in a class that I was teaching. I taught anatomy and physiology and a number of other things in a naturopathic school, and we trained naturopaths, massage therapists, anybody else that wanted to come. We had a fair number of nurse practitioners who come and take the course and stuff. Because we would go through and we would work every bone and muscle in the body that you could work without being called a prostitute in the process. And one of the ladies that was in one of the classes was named Mary. And Mary thought she was just wonderful. Well, we were talking about this process, about, you know, not really being the healer, but being the one that the energy flows through. And she said, "No, I am the healer." And I thought, "Well, no, Mary, you're not." And we talked about it, and she said, "No, I am the healer." I said, "Okay, here's what you can expect. Somewhere down the way, you're going to get to a point where your arrogance is going to get in the way, and the spirits are going to cut you off, and they're not going to let that energy flow through you anymore. And when that happens, then nothing that you do is going to get it back until the spirits have decided that you have gotten to the point that you have learned your lesson and you're not going to do this anymore. And then you know that you are not the healer, that you are simply the energy, that the healing, the process, you're the conduit that the healing process flows through to the person who's receiving the healing." Well, a couple weeks went by and Mary came to class, and she got up and said that she had an announcement. And, you know, we hadn't heard Mary in a while, so I was like, "Okay, Mary, what's your announcement?" And she said, "I've decided that I'm not going to do energy work anymore. I'm just going to do massage." And everybody laughed because they knew what had happened. Mary wouldn't talk about it. So she'd been cut off, that energy didn't flow through her anymore. Now, chances are, you know, in 2, 3, 4 years, you know, it'd get to where she can try it again with a new understanding and it would flow just fine. But a lot of people, when they go through that, they don't try again. Sad, but you know, if you're one of those that's had that energy cut off at some point in the past, you know, if you have a right understanding at this point, then try it again sometime and see what happens. You may be surprised. There are some other things that are perils along the way in the spiritual path. One is just about the time that you decide that you're going to do something that is really going to make a change in your life for the good and for your spiritual life. then you will be tested. One of those ways that you're tested is the dark light says, hey, you know, I really don't want this to happen. You know, I have an apprentice who's on the way here right now. I say she's on the way here right now. She will actually be on the way tomorrow. She doesn't care if she's only here for a day or what, you know, she's going to get here because the Dark Lodge has been trying to prevent her getting here to do something that is absolutely going to rock the world. Have you ever heard of master plants? Well, we're about to release a master plant initiation series that she's going to be the surrogate for. And I can promise you that this is going to change the world. It's going to change the world in a very good way, and it's actually happening at the instigation of another apprentice in Australia. But this lady is one of the most powerful set of prostitutes alive. I mean, she's wonderful. And she's going to be coming here, and she has had one thing after another get in her way, starting with alternator of her car going out, and then braking suspension problems, and all kinds of things. And the Dark Lodge just continued to put one thing after another in front of her to try and keep her from coming here, the time limit that she has, to be a part of this process. Well, if she rolls in for 5 minutes, we sit her down, take a picture around the energy, and then she gets in her car and goes home again, they still will have lost. But the Dark Lodge will try and interfere with your process. There's another thing that happens to interfere with your process, too. And that is that the spirits that you work with, the good spirits and stuff, you know, that they will test you. And spiritual tests are not fun. There was a gentleman recently who was going to do some stuff that would have been very good for him. He knew it was going to be very good for him. And just a few hours before he was going to get that process begun, then he found out that his girlfriend was pregnant. Well, you know, that's a money concern, let me tell you. And so he decided that he wasn't going to do that right now. And chances are great that it was simply a test. I went through a test a few years ago. It wasn't fun. The spirits stopped talking to me. The goddess stopped talking to me. So it didn't matter what I did. Nothing and no one spoke to me. And so the only thing that I could do is what was in front of me to do, as long as I knew it was good and I could do it in a good way that would be useful for the rest of creation. And this went on for 2 years. And I would do my ritual work, and I would do my puja stuff, and I would do healing work for people, I would death walk folks along the way, you know, basically a death walk is Native American hospice work. We're actually going to do a series on that. When we get it all done, it'll probably take about 4 hours of video work, which will show you, teach you everything that you need to know to be able to do death walking, which is essentially Native American hospice work. So, you know, anyway, I would do that sort of thing and whatnot. And finally, after about 2 years, then there was a curandera, a Mexican medicine woman by the name of Rosa Carvajal, and Rosa and I have been friends for years, and worked together, and basically Rosa and a friend of hers, several friends of hers, some of her students basically, were with her, and they knocked on my door. And I went, whipped the door open, and, you know, asked them what they were doing, and they said, well, they'd come to see me. They felt like they should. And I said, well, I'm about to do something rather interesting. You're welcome to join in if you would like. So we went in, I took my clothes off, got the altar, and it was all set up and whatnot, and I lit the candles on it and all this sort of thing, lit some incense, you know, shared the incense around, and then, you know, and we smudged everybody and stuff. So, you know, we'd gotten everything done that you possibly do, and then I said, all right, here's how it is. Either you spirits start talking to me again, and God, you start talking to me again, because if you don't, this is what you can expect from me. And I just wiped out the whole altar and just threw it all on the floor. And I said, if you don't start speaking to me now, I'm going to take all of this stuff, I'm going to put it in the trash, I'm going to throw it in. I'm never going to have anything to do with you again. And Russia and her friends were a little freaked out. And 5 minutes later, the phone rang, and it was my boss. At the time, I wasn't able to do this work full time, but, you know, I had a mundane job like so many of my apprentices do, and, you know, eventually it worked into being a full-time thing. But at that point, I was working for a company doing loss control engineering for insurance underwriters and mortgage companies and things of this nature. And so my boss was on the phone, and he said, we need you to move to Oklahoma. And I said, why on earth would I want to move back to Oklahoma? And he said, because if you don't, you won't have a job. And I'm like, okay, do I have a choice about where I go? And he said, either Oklahoma City or Tulsa. And I said, Tulsa. And so, I've been wanting to have a spiritual life again and stuff. I didn't have any apprentices locally in New Mexico anymore. I had friends like Russell, but you know, I didn't have my usual for me with people to work with and teach. And I knew that as soon as I got back to Tulsa that I would, and I did. And it was great and wonderful and amazing, and the Spirit spoke to me again. The spirits will test you sometimes by seeming to cut you off, and they will do it for the purpose of seeing just how faithful you're going to be. And usually, if you wait it out, there's a much greater reward later on. I can't complain at all about what I got, but chances are great. If I simply stuck it out and done what I was supposed to do and whatnot, and not had a temper tantrum and wiped out my altar and threatened the spirits and stuff, that it might have gone on another month, 2 months, maybe 10 minutes, who knows? And they would have been speaking to me again, and what came through would have been wonderful. There are other times when we have perils along the way, and one of those perils is assuming that we have arrived, that we are the fully awakened and self-aware master. I can say that I'm a master of the Tibetan Kapalika-Gora path, but that is not the same thing. I know that I am not the be-all and end-all in the spirit world. I know that I don't corner the market on the worship of the goddess. I know that there are lots of other people that I can learn from, and I seek those people out all the time. And I nonetheless encounter many people along the way who think that they are absolutely, you know, the goddess's greatest gift to all of humanity. And they're here for a while, and then they're not. Because, again, you know, none of us know everything. If we did know everything, we wouldn't be here anymore. We would have gone on already. So, there are other things that come along, though, in the spiritual work that are an impediment on the path. And one of those is fear. And the fear is usually not so much about, oh, I'm afraid I'm going to get hurt if I do this. Sometimes the fear is you really don't want to face your darkness, your own shadows and stuff. We all have it. You know, we do need to make peace with it. Once we do, then we're able to move into a greater area of mastery and understanding of our mastery and who we are as far as a reflection of the divinity. But the fear that most people have is not about their darkness or their evil or any things of this nature. It's of their goodness. They are afraid to realize how truly good and wonderful and powerful they are. And again, powerful not in the sense of that they are the power, but simply that they are, you know, how wonderful a channel they are for the energy of the goddess to move through and affect things in this world. People are very rarely afraid of being small or dark or evil or anything like that. They are afraid of their goodness. And, you know, it's like, oh, you know, I can never be that way. I mean, people told me how stupid I was all my life growing up. You know, people told me how bad I was or how I was never going to amount to anything. You know, when we were growing up, everyone in my family said that my brother was either going to be president of the United States or he's going to be hung. Well, he hasn't been hung, unfortunately, and he's not going to be president. That's okay, you know. He knew he was either going to do great things or horrible things, and in his own way, he's done some pretty neat things in his life. So, you know, those are the kind of perils that I'm talking about here as far as the spiritual path. Test by the spirits that you work with that you may or may not pass. Attacked by the Dark Lodge because they're afraid of what you're going to become, and maybe you back off because you don't want to go through it. I mean, I've had apprentices who were supposed to do some really great things, but they simply didn't follow through. They had some wonderful opportunities, so one of them didn't follow through on something, kind of kept messing around, and the spirits took what she was supposed to be doing away from her. And, you know, a couple of years later, though, she had continued to do what she was supposed to do, and she'd grown, and she learned a lot and stuff. And she's head of one of the more interesting medicine societies in this part of the world now. The female head of it, it's a man who's the male head of it, but she's the female head of it. She's their dragon mother. And she claims to be an interim dragon mother, but everyone on the Asagai Council of Elders knows that she's the one for the job. She earned it. She earned it by learning and moving past the things that happened when she didn't do what she was supposed to do before. I mean, she's a magnificent lady. So. There are, you know, other things that come along, little things that kind of stumble, distractions that happen that kind of pull you off your path and you need to kind of get back on again. But, you know, if you're simply aware of the energy. You know, like I have a teacher who is always talking about energy, you know, is this energy good for me? You know, if you check with something and you find that, okay, maybe it feels good at the moment, but ultimately that energy is really going to be bad, leave it alone. Live alone, you know. Go do something else. But, you know, if the energy is good for you, then chances are great. That's the direction that you're supposed to be going in. And, you know, if the energy feeds you in a good way that's not ramping up your ego or stuff, people sometimes have an out-of-control ego. And some people say, well, you need to get rid of your ego. Don't listen to that. And don't try to do it. Your ego is what motivates you to make change. So, if your spiritual life is going well and you're learning good things, doing good things, the energy is good for you and stuff, and you're not getting all full of yourself in the process, then chances are you have managed to discipline your ego. But that ego will still motivate you to do things along the way. And sometimes the motivation that the ego is giving you is one of those things where, oh, it looks good at the moment, but you meditated a little bit and say, oh, no, you know, that energy is going to be bad down here. So you leave it alone. But you go with the other things that your ego motivates you to do, and more and more and more as you discipline your ego, then it'll get to where it leads you right. There are all sorts of ways to test things. You can muscle test, you can feel how things are in your solar plexus, you know, the top of the intrabrain, which, you know, your gut reaction to things, you know. You can also look at other feelings, like if you choose to do something and it feels really good overall and it's kind of expansive and empowering and stuff, you know, then chances are it's the way you're supposed to go. But you decide to do something else or to not do something that you felt like you should do, and there's a little sadness, a little wistfulness, a little shrinking and disappointment and stuff, you know, then chances are that you need to take another look at the direction that you're supposed to be going. So, you know, there are lots of tools along the way. Like, we have a guardian animal. We'll do some videos on how to get a guardian animal and stuff pretty soon. But if you have a guardian animal or an upper realm teacher, you know, you can go and talk with them. You can go for a walk in the woods and say, okay, I'm going to look for five things in nature. It doesn't have to be the woods, it can be the desert, it can be anywhere. I'm going to go look for five things in nature that speak to me about the problem that I'm having. And you can go and do that and get some information. You can do muscle testing. You can use a pendulum. You know, you can do divination with playing cards or dice or any number of other things. And you can get the answers that you need as to where you're supposed to be going with your spiritual path. So, the perils are there, but the way through is also there. If you trust the spirits, you honor the goddess, then you'll be led in the way that you should go. So, that's it for now, and we'll do a little bit more tomorrow. Take care.